In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. The priest council suggested a few months back that we move this celebration of the Chrism Mass from the afternoon to the evening so that more of the Lord's faithful people could participate in this beautiful liturgy and support their priests as they renew their promises. Well, you have shown up, the faithful people of God. I am most impressed. My question, though, is, are you here because we made it later, or because our preacher is Bishop-elect Ruggieri? Something tells me if we had scheduled it at 3 a.m. with you as the preacher, we'd still have a full church. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most serious fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who anointed your only begotten Son with the Holy Spirit and made him Christ and Lord, graciously grant that, being made sharers in his consecration, we may bear witness to your redemption in the world. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to announce a year of favor from the Lord and a day of vindication by our God, to comfort all who mourn, to place on those who mourn in Zion a diadem instead of ashes, to give them oil of gladness in place of mourning, a glorious mantle instead of a listless spirit. You yourselves shall be named priests of the Lord, ministers of our God you shall be called. I will give them their recompense faithfully, a lasting covenant I will make with them. Their descendants shall be renowned among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge them as a race the Lord has blessed. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Del libro del profeta, perdón, del libro del Apocalipsis del apóstol San Juan. Hermanos míos, gracias y paz a ustedes, de parte de Jesucristo, el testigo fiel, el primogénito de entre los muertos, el soberano de los reyes de la tierra, aquel que nos amó y nos purificó de nuestros pecados con su sangre y ha hecho de nosotros un reino de sacerdotes para su Dios y Padre. A Él la gloria y el poder por los siglos de los siglos. Amén. Miren, Él viene entre las nubes y todos lo verán, aun aquellos que lo traspasaron. Todos los pueblos de la tierra harán duelo por su causa. Yo soy el Alfa y el Omega, dice el Señor Dios, el que es, el que era y el que ha de venir, el Todopoderoso. Palabra de Dios.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had grown up, and went according to his custom into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. He stood up to read and was handed a scroll of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and found the passage where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring glad tidings to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim a year acceptable to the Lord." Rolling up the scroll, he handed it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of all in the synagogue looked intently at him. He said to them, "Today this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Bishop Henning, I want to thank you for the opportunity tonight to preach. I want to thank you for your leadership. In the very short time that you have been with us, you have shown yourself to be a good shepherd to the people and to the priests of our diocese. I'm personally very grateful for that. Bishop Evans, thank you for your ministry over the years in the diocese. Your presence in my life goes way back. I'm very grateful also to you and for your presence here tonight. My dear brother priests, what a privilege it is to share with you in this Chrism Mass, my last as a priest of Providence, but it has been truly an honor to serve with you in the diocese. Some of you I have served with more closely, of course, and others the bond is simple, but it's real, the bond that we are priests of Providence. Thank you for your ministry. My dear brother deacons, religious, lay faithful of our diocese, thank you for being here tonight and for your witness of service and commitment. A special word of welcome to our seminarians who are here present tonight as well. The harvest is abundant, no doubt. Thank you, my dear seminarians, for saying yes to discern with the church at this time in your life the movement of the Holy Spirit. I'd ask you, please, all faithful, to pray for our seminarians. Pray for our two transitional deacons who will be ordained priests this June, Deacon Joseph and Deacon Hiron. Please pray for more seminarians. Please pray for more priests. My dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, it is really a privilege to be here and to share in this Chrism Mass. As the ceremonial bishop says, the Chrism Mass is a clear expression of the unity of the priesthood. We demonstrate that unity by our presence with our bishop. We demonstrate that unity by our witness and cooperation in the consecration of the chrism. Our bishop shares the fullness of holy orders, and we as priests, by sharing in the ministerial priesthood with him, assist him in the pastoral ministry of the faithful of this local church. Bishop Henning, tonight as we renew our priestly promises in your presence and in the presence of the faithful who are here praying with us and for us, as we did as priests on our ordination day when we placed our hands in the hands of the ordaining bishop and promised obedience, tonight we collectively as a presbyterate place our hands in yours and once again commit obediently to follow your leadership and to collaborate with you as you are shepherd and as you shepherd all the souls of this great diocese. My dear brothers, as we collaborate and support our bishop as ordained priests, our great ministry is to be Christ for others. The ontological reality of holy orders brings a great responsibility. The Christ we witness in the gospel tonight is the Christ we must witness to others. The Spirit works with the Son. The Spirit must be allowed to work through us and our humanity, forming us to be joyful bearers of the good news, bold proclaimers of real liberation and authentic freedom from sin and death, living examples of incarnate love. Authentic joy is based on authentic love. Therefore, as priests and as the baptized faithful here tonight who share in the priesthood of Christ, we are called to authentic love. One thing the scriptures teach us, love saves. Love liberates. To be a priest is to be called to authentic love and to be called to daily conversion. How fitting, for if I am to preach this gospel, this message of conversion to the faithful, this message of love and liberation, I must first be willing to be converted. In his 1979 Holy Thursday letter to all priests, St. John Paul II wrote that the call to conversion is addressed to everyone, and in particular to priests. He wrote, "If we have the duty of helping others to be converted, we have to do the same continuously in our lives." For St. John Paul II in this letter, being converted means giving an account to God of our hearts, about our service, our zeal, and our fidelity. It means giving an account of our negligence and sins, of our timidity, of our lack of faith and hope. Being converted means seeking the strength of God in the sacrament of reconciliation. Being converted means to pray continually and never lose heart. As we continue in our own process of conversion, one outward consequence will be that we will be men of community. Love does not seek its own interest, as St. Paul reminds us so beautifully. And in our polarized society, we are called to imitate what we celebrate in the sacred work that we are called to do. The Eucharist calls us to be people who gather God's people. The homily in the ordination rite for priests says, "Remember, when you gather others into the people of God through baptism, and when you forgive sins in the name of Christ and the Church in the sacrament of penance, when you comfort the sick with holy oil and celebrate the sacred rites, when you offer prayers of praise and thanks to God throughout the hours of the day, not only for the people of God, but for the whole world, remember then that you are taken from among men and appointed on their behalf for those things that pertain to God. Therefore, carry out the ministry of Christ the priest with constant joy and genuine love, attending not to your own concerns, but to those of Jesus Christ." My brothers, our work as priests, our holy work, should gather God's people, especially the marginalized and the outcasts. Our holy work should not shame, but convict others of their dignity as we call them to conversion by our example. Our holy work should not create an us versus them reality, but rather a greater sense of us, church, as broken as we are at this moment. Come, Holy Spirit, bring greater unity, trust, and peace in our church and in our world. As I am about to leave this great diocese, I have had the chance to reflect on some significant people who have had significant impact on my life. One of those is my father, of happy memory. When I was newly ordained a deacon and began my diaconate year at St. Matthew in Cranston in the spring of 1994, Father Clyde Walsh, also of happy memory, was my first pastor. I love Father Walsh. He was disciplined, organized. He loved the sick and homebound. He memorized the names of probably 98% of his parishioners. He prayed and preached with conviction, all the things that I saw lacking in my own life at that time. Father Walsh helped me to become acclimated to parish life, and he introduced me at that time to the people of St. Matthew as Father Ruggieri, although I was a transitional deacon. As I became more and more comfortable with the father part added to my name, and as I began to embrace the new life of an ordained minister, my father would visit me from time to time at St. Matthew, and he heard people address me as Father Ruggieri. So one time my father said to me, and he would repeat it from time to time, James, remember, I am the real Father Ruggieri. My father was a man of great integrity and humility, and he was right. He knew himself, and he knew his vocation. Brothers, may we never stop striving to know ourselves and our vocation as ordained priests. The one way this will happen is through genuine relationships, meaningful, authentic, genuine friendships. The human Jesus knew this. That's why he chose friendship with 12, and also women. May we become more and more who we are called to be, in humility and integrity. Mary, Mother of Priests, pray for us.
May I ask the priests to please stand. Beloved sons, on the anniversary of that day, when Christ our Lord conferred his priesthood on his apostles and on us, are you resolved to renew, in the presence of your bishop and God's holy people, the promises you once made? Are you resolved to be more united with the Lord Jesus and more closely conformed to him, denying yourselves and confirming those promises about sacred duties towards Christ's church, which, prompted by love of him, you willingly and joyfully pledged on the day of your priestly ordination?
I am.
Are you resolved to be faithful stewards of the mysteries of God in the Holy Eucharist and the other liturgical rites, and to discharge faithfully the sacred office of teaching, following Christ the head and shepherd, not seeking any gain, but moved only by zeal for souls? May I ask the faithful now to kindly rise? As for you, dearest sons and daughters, pray for your priests, that the Lord may pour out his gifts abundantly upon them and keep them faithful as ministers of Christ, the High Priest, so that they may lead you to him who is the source of salvation. And pray also for me, that I may be faithful to the apostolic office entrusted to me in my lowliness, and that in your midst I may be made day by day a living and more perfect image of Christ, the priest, the good shepherd, the teacher, and the servant of all. May the Lord keep us all in his charity, and lead all of us, shepherds and flock, to eternal life. Amen. Kindly be seated.
Thank you.
O God, Father of all consolation, who willed to heal the infirmities of the weak through your Son, listen favorably to the prayer of faith. Send forth from the heavens, we pray, your Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, upon this oil in all its richness, which you have graciously brought forth from the verdant tree, to restore the body, so that by your holy blessing, everyone anointed with this oil, as a safeguard for body, soul, and spirit, may be freed from all pain, all infirmity, and all sickness. May your holy oil, O Lord, be blessed by you for our sake. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, lives and reigns with you forever and ever. Amen. O God, strength and protection of your people, who have made the oil you created a sign of strength, graciously bless this oil and grant courage to the catechumens who will be anointed with it, so that receiving divine wisdom and power, they may understand more deeply the gospel of your Christ, that they may undertake with a generous heart the labors of the Christian life, and made worthy of adoption as your sons and daughters, they may rejoice to be born anew and to live in your church through Christ our Lord. Let us pray, dear brothers and sisters, to God the Almighty Father, that he may bless and sanctify this oil, so that all who are outwardly anointed with it may be inwardly transformed and come to share in eternal salvation. O God, author of all growth and spiritual progress, receive in your goodness the grateful homage that the Church joyfully offers to you through our voice. For in the beginning you commanded the earth to bring forth fruit-bearing trees, among which olive trees would arise as the providers of this most rich oil, so that their fruit might serve for sacred chrism. In the spirit of prophecy, David foresaw the sacraments of your grace and sang of the oil that would gladden our faces. After the world's offenses were washed away by the flood, a dove announced the restoration of peace on earth with the olive branch, foreshadowing the gift to come. In the last days, all this has been clearly revealed. When every offense is removed through the waters of baptism, the anointing with this oil causes our faces to be joyful and serene. You also commanded your servant Moses to make his brother Aaron a priest by pouring this oil upon him after he had been washed in water. Still greater dignity was added to this when your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, insisted that he be washed by John in the waters of the Jordan. You sent the Holy Spirit from on high in the likeness of a dove. You declared by the witness of the voice that followed that you were well pleased in him, your only begotten Son. And you were seen to confirm clearly what the prophet David had foretold in song, that Christ would be anointed with the oil of gladness above his companions. Therefore, we beseech you, Lord, be pleased to sanctify with your blessing this oil and its richness, and to pour into it the strength of the Holy Spirit with the powerful working of your Christ. From his holy name it has received the name of Chrism, and with it you have anointed your priests, prophets, kings, and martyrs. May you confirm the chrism you have created as a sacred sign of perfect salvation and life for those to be made new in the spiritual waters of baptism. May those formed into a temple of your majesty by the holiness infused through this anointing and by the cleansing of the stain of their first birth be made fragrant with the innocence of a life pleasing to you. May those anointed with royal, priestly, and prophetic dignity be clothed with the garment of an incorruptible gift, in keeping with the sacrament you have established. May this oil be the chrism of salvation for those born again of water and the Holy Spirit, and may it make them partakers of eternal life and sharers of heavenly glory, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your children, for the praise of the Lord, for our good.
May the power of this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, mercifully wipe away what is old in us, and increase in us grace of salvation and newness of life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you made your only begotten Son, High Priest of the new and eternal covenant. And by your wondrous design, we're pleased to decree that his one priesthood should continue in the church. For Christ not only adorns with a royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with a brother's kindness, he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. They are to renew in his name the sacrifice of human redemption, to set before your children the paschal banquet, to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word and strengthen them with the sacraments. As they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as in exultation we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you."
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saints Peter and Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Richard, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be.
Protect me, Lord. I come to you for safety. I say you are my God. All good things, Lord, all good things that I have come from you, the God of my salvation.
Our lives are in your hands.
Let us pray. We beseech you, Almighty God, that those you renew by your sacraments may merit to become the pleasing fragrance of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Would you kindly be seated? If I may just offer a few words of gratitude to those who worked very hard in order to assist us in our prayer this evening. Obviously, we owe a debt of gratitude to Monsignor Mancini, Dr. Farone, the choir, and the musicians who have helped us to pray twice. As the saying goes, thank you very much for the very beautiful music that you have made, that joyful noise to the Lord. I'm grateful also to the seminarians, all those who've served the liturgy, to Father Nathan Ritchie, who has been working tirelessly to prepare this liturgy and make sure I did everything I was supposed to do. So I really appreciated all of those whispered directions. It makes it possible for me to kind of let go and trust and pray in the Mass. So it's a great gift. Special word of thanks to the young people from the youth groups at St. Philip's in Greenville and St. Luke's in Barrington. They assisted us tonight with preparing the oils and also as ushers in this liturgy this evening. And I'm grateful to many of the chancery staff who gave of their time this afternoon and this evening to help prepare for this evening's Mass. I think that was the list, Father Ritchie. Okay, all right. So thank you to all those who helped us to pray. And I want to give praise and glory to Almighty God for the gift of this time with you tonight. Praise and glory to God for the gift of our priests who are present here tonight in such numbers, for their good shepherding and their priestly hearts. Praise and glory to God for our brother deacons who kind of accompany us in that priestly ministry. Praise and glory to God for Bishop Evans and Bishop-elect Ruggieri. We're very grateful for that beautiful homily. Wherever you go, I feel it, the Spirit is at work. So thank you for helping us. Maybe for that reason above all, we are so very happy and devastated all at the same time with this news from the Holy Father. God bless him. He picked the right guy. But if only he had noticed you. Una palabrita quisiera ofrecer alabanza y gloria a Dios por la presencia de los que hablan español esta noche. Ustedes tienen la mirada de fe que nos da mucha fuerza, mucho gozo en el sacerdocio. So, gracias por su presencia esta noche, rezando al lado de sus sacerdotes. I'm so very, very grateful to God. I give praise and glory to God for the presence of you, the good people of God, our religious sisters, and all of you gathered here this evening. You are the ones that give us kind of that joy and that force of the Spirit in our ministry. It is for you that the Lord has called us. And so we are grateful that you have come to pray with us this evening and to walk beside us in that journey of priestly ministry and, in fact, in that journey towards the Lord that is the life of discipleship. So thank you all. May this be a holy week filled with graces and blessing for you and yours. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.